Hello and good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening. I'm really glad you could all make it to this event that's being co-hosted by the St. Paul's Institute and JustShare. My name is Emily Brown. I am the temporary JustShare coordinator while Trisha is on maternity leave. And I am delighted to welcome our chair, Helen Wildsmith, who is the Stewardship Director for Climate Change from the CCLA. So without further ado, I'll just hand over to Helen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and good evening, everybody. This is my first time with a wandering around mic, so I might be tempted to start to dance, so do stop me if I do that. I wanted to start just by saying, you know, how fantastic it is to see so many people, including familiar faces, and to thank our two host organisations for pulling together what I'm sure is going to be a very interesting discussion. About once a year, the St. Paul's Institute and JustShare come together for an event. And I think this one is perfect for both of their missions. The St. Paul's Institute focuses on looking at justice and the financial sector. And JustShare is a coalition of churches and charities working together on development and justice. And I think climate change and the role of the private sector and policymakers is just spot on in terms of a sweet spot for those organisations. On my way here, I was just thinking about the debate we're going to have and just thinking about time and place and thinking that this is a perfect time to be having this discussion, not only because we're about a quarter now beyond the agreement in Paris, but also this has been a week of news that has been at turns good and bad. At the beginning of the week, we had the news that already this year looks like it's going to break records in terms of temperature, which makes us think, what time do we have left for this complex transition that we're going to go through? And then today, to wake up to the front page of the Financial Times and see that we might have had a second year of plateauing emissions. So good and bad news this week. But in terms of place, and for this particular debate, this church is very close to my heart. People who specialize, like I do, in climate finance in the city meet here for breakfast once a month to talk about what's happening in climate change and think through what are the roles of businesses, investors, and policymakers on this really critical issue for society. And those breakfasts are punctuated by retreats that we have with policymakers and investors trying to think through what do we need to do over the coming months. And we've got one of those coming up after Easter. So this is a perfect chance to learn from our two experts on topics to take into that next retreat. Which leads me into my introductions. You've got bios in the leaflet, so I'm not going to read everything out. But I just wanted to point out that both Jonathan Shopley and Baroness Worthington, who will be speaking for the motion and against it, have both got really interesting backgrounds that span the different sectors in society. So they do have a very good insight on the roles that the different sectors can play. In terms of public policy, Baroness Worthington involved in writing the climate change bill, the first one in the world, and has been shadow at DEC most recently. And Jonathan involved in setting up the all-party parliamentary group on climate change. Baroness Worthington now working with the Environmental Defence Fund, bringing together that sort of civil society push in terms of what we all need to do, but also spent some time working for SSE, the big utilities company. And Jonathan working with the private sector in terms of carbon neutral, and actually in the earlier days of his career, bringing the sustainability message to businesses while he was a consultant at AD Little. So two people with very good insights about the strengths and the weaknesses of the different players in society, who I'm sure are going to bring great insight to this question. So we start with 10 minutes from each of them. We have cards at the back to make sure that people don't overrun their time, both red and orange ones, 2 and 5 minutes to go. To remind you of the question, should the private sector lead on climate change? Over to you, Jonathan.
Right, let me just do a sound check. How's that at the back? Good, thank you. Pardon? Too loud. Okay. How's that? I'll try and modulate it. I'll watch you if you grimace. I know it's either my arguments or my booming voice. But I'd like to start by thanking St. Paul's Institute and JustShare for your kind invitation to participate in this event, and I'm thrilled to be here. And it's a huge honor for me to be debating whether the private sector or government should lead the charge on climate change with Baroni, whose engagement with and understanding of energy and climate policy I hold in the highest regard. However, that does not mean we have a shared view of the role of government in leading the response to climate change. In fact, I intend to make the case that government is the least qualified candidate for leadership. And if society stands expectant on government, we're as good as sunk in the rising tides and extreme weather that will surely follow. I've got three main arguments to support my view. First, government is grossly conflicted to the point where its leadership on a response to climate risks makes no sense. 65% of greenhouse gas emissions are from the use of fossil fuels. Governments are the owners of the rights to these resources and have either sold the rights to the private sector, or, as is the case for the majority of oil and gas production, own and exploit fossil resources through state-owned and controlled enterprises. And as it happens, a very similar situation exists for another material source of greenhouse gas emissions, the exploitation and destruction of forests, which accounts for a further 15%+ of the global greenhouse gas emission total. Where rights have been transferred to the private sector, governments are dependent, or more accurately, addicted to the tax revenues raised on private sector profits. That gross dependency is highlighted by the fact that across the world, subsidies to the fossil fuel sector amount to over $500 billion per year, $550 billion to be precise. That support is to an established, mature industry that is killing our citizens and polluting the environment. In contrast, the fledgling renewable energy sector receives less than a fifth of that amount. The point I'm making is that governments have not and cannot take the lead because that would conflict with their vested short-term interests. It's what I call government's locked-in syndrome. Rationally, we understand the need to act, but we are pinned down. Former president of Shell Oil, John Hofmeister, said it slightly differently, and I quote, "Never, ever, ever underestimate the power of the status quo. It is huge." And that takes me to my second argument. Business is already in the lead, and that could well be a consequence of the fact that businesses succeed when they respond to the preferences expressed by customers and consumers every minute of every day, rather than support the remote electorate voting once every 4 or 5 years. But don't get me wrong, governments do critically important work, and Paris was a success because 196 nations came up with an agreement which will provide a framework for action. And Paris succeeded where Copenhagen failed back in 2009 by committing all nations to national plans aimed at limiting temperature rise to 2 degrees Celsius or less. So what changed in the 6 years leading up to Paris? Well, most notably, Christiana Figueres, who took the UN lead on international climate negotiations after Copenhagen, broke ranks with her government paymasters by spending a significant proportion of her time engaging with the private sector, asking for its support. And it was given loud and clear by business organizations, including the World Business Council for Sustainable Development, 200 companies proactively taking action on sustainable development, the CDP, or Climate Disclosure Project as it was called, representing $95 trillion of investments, asking corporations what their climate change strategies are. RE100, in which a growing number of corporates are signing up to a commitment to be 100% renewable energy by 2020, and others like We Mean Business, the B Team, science-based targets, including WWF and WRI, and the New York Declaration on Forests. You might say that these alliances don't represent the status quo, and you'd be wrong. BP, Shell, and a large number of traditional companies called for a price on carbon to help their businesses make a smooth transition to a low-carbon economy. Backing these calls for action is plenty of real action from the private sector. Microsoft, as an example, has for 4 years now made its operations carbon neutral through an internal carbon fee raised on emissions across all of its business units or operations around the world. The funds raised are redeployed to drive internal reductions, to procuring 100% renewable energy, and to fund carbon offset projects selected to support energy access in communities around the developing world. The UN recognized this leadership with a Momentum for Change award to Microsoft at the Paris summit. Many other organizations are well on their way to getting to zero, including H&M, Marks and Spencer's, Google, Sky, and others. But none of these companies are doing this because of regulations or climate policy. They're doing it to manage risks and maintain and improve their competitive positions in a rapidly changing world. However, let me go back to the Paris Agreement. The 2 degree or less commitment, and it's just a commitment at this stage, isn't a safeguard target. Even if we are successful, scientists still believe there's a reasonable probability that complex interactions already in train across the biosphere can tip us into a new and highly disruptive set of weather patterns. The oceanographer John Englander believes we've already locked in sea level rise over the coming century that will wipe out hundreds of trillions of dollars of coastal infrastructure around the world. So we have the Paris Agreement that will mitigate emissions to a safe limit, maybe. What we need is a massive wave of innovation to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, draw down atmospheric concentrations of greenhouse gases to a safe level, and help society adapt to the new climate risks and realities of the next century. In the words of the US architect William McDonough, being less bad is a great thing to do and has the right trajectory, but it is insufficient to the task of creating a sustaining world. Simply reducing the things we don't want, like carbon, won't achieve the results we do want, like renewable energy. And that takes me to my final point. Regulation and policy will not solve climate change. The power of business to innovate will. To develop this final argument, I need the help of the Russian economist Kondratiev. Kondratieff, working in the 20th century, hypothesized from a study of economic, social, cultural life and free market data that free market economies go through roughly 50-year-long long-wave cycles of boom and bust. He noted technology's role in leading the way out of contraction into the next wave. He saw depressions as cleansing periods that allow economic readjustment from previous excesses to provide a base for future growth. They are a time of innovation in which technologies are refined, made cheaper, and more widely distributed. Today's long wave adherents coalesce around five technology-driven waves or revolutions, starting with the Industrial Revolution, driven by steam. That was 1780 to 1830. Railways, heavy engineering enabled by steel, chemicals enabled by electricity, automobile and mass production of consumer goods enabled by petrochemicals, 1930 to 1970, and then the communications era, or long wave, that we're in right now, enabled by computer technologies. Business has taken us up to the brink of the sixth long wave. Natural capitalism enabled by renewable energy, nanotechnology, biotechnology, and closed-loop zero-waste production and consumption. Thanks. Is there evidence to support this? You bet. Let's look at the energy sector. Despite fragmented or no government regulation to support the renewable energy sector has, in some technologies, wind and solar, reached cost parity with a highly subsidized fuel and nuclear sector. Costs are falling and effectiveness increasing in the energy storage sector too, and within a decade or so, the combination of cost-efficient storage and renewable generation will bring highly distributed energy to the world markets, disrupting and ultimately displacing the status quo of more expensive, polluting, centralized energy supply. Can we regulate for that level of disruption, that required revolution? No. Can we accelerate the necessary transformation? Certainly, if we recognize the lead role of the private sector and that it is already playing so well. Of course, as with all transformations, the next one won't be without its risks and social and environmental impacts. Governments need to do its job in maintaining the social contract and do it better, protecting society from polluters, liars, and cheats, without falling prey again to the locked-in syndrome. Three things done well by governments will make a huge positive difference in supporting the private sector's work and leadership. Do the enabling research that supports the transition, as government did for all the key technologies that make your phone smart, GPS, touchscreen, voice enabled. Make markets work better by putting a price on carbon and a value on natural capital. And finally, the third, shift the basis for taxation from labor to scarce resources. A focus on these three critically important enabling activities is probably all governments really need to do to support the private sector as it leads us into the next long wave, natural capitalism. It certainly has the track record, the courage, and the funds, and the innovative instincts to do so. Thanks.
So there we are, the private sector, the innovator, the leader, the public sector, the enabler to make sure we get there on time. So now, the case against the question.
Thank you, and I'd like to echo Jonathan's words of thanks for being invited here to address you today, and for you have chosen such an interesting topic for us to debate tonight. Obviously, as with all of these debates, the answer is not a clear yes or no. It's always going to be a compromise of a bit of both, but that would be very dull. So I'm going to make the case that actually the private sector cannot lead on climate change, and that actually it's a much broader spectrum of actors who are going to have to show leadership through collaboration that's going to solve climate change. And in fact, the very concept of leadership on climate change is something that's very, very hard to pin down, because it's not like the Apollo project, where we were simply trying to do a specific task of landing someone on the moon and getting them back safely, which could be done through really determined leadership of a handful of people in a room, clever engineers with a budget and a common goal. We're not facing that kind of challenge. We're facing a global transition away from a highly capitalized and very mature energy system to something completely new. And actually, in that endeavor, there are going to be multiple leaders, and they're going to come from all walks of life. So it's not a question of whether the private sector should lead. We all need to lead, whatever the role we're in, because this is by far and away the biggest threat that we face as humanity. We are incredibly blessed with what we've achieved as a race, as humanity. We are clothing ourselves and feeding ourselves and protecting ourselves from disease more successfully than ever before in history on aggregate. Now, that's not to say that hasn't come at a price, and it has come at a price that currently is threatening our natural systems upon which life depends. And that potential evolutionary bottleneck really means that we need to take stock and make sure that we don't see the progress we've made collectively being reversed. And that's the challenge of climate change. So why is it that this idea that the private sector somehow should lead is wrong? Well, firstly, as I've said, it's a question of shared leadership rather than any one part of society leading. But there are also really important things that, though Jonathan quite rightly captured some of the best parts of the private sector, their dynamism, their innovation. I've worked in the private sector. I've seen how fast they can move when they're motivated to do so. But there's been a little bit of a glossing over here of the other aspect of the private sector. And that is that generally they are governed by very short-term thinking. And it's getting ever shorter. The people who I've witnessed in the private sector are incredibly motivated individuals, but often the thing that guides them is a share price ticker that's usually prominently in display in their headquarters that they watch continually to ensure that it's their share price is going up. That's the metric of success for most private sector companies. Now, there are many companies who can make that share price rise by doing the right thing, by providing products and services that make our world a better place. But there are still a large number of companies who now knowingly want to make that share price rise, but know in doing so that they are creating a risk that the rest of us are going to bear. In the words of an economist, it's simply the problem of an externality, the common good. Those individual companies are going to be collectively exposed to the risks that we all face, but they, on the other hand, also have an incentive to continue to maximize their profit. And it's that externality, that shared disbenefit that they can ignore in the short term, that means that they're incapable, many of them, of making the transition. Because they're not in control. They're in the hands of investors and shareholders who want to see a return on their money, and that return has to be delivered quickly, quarterly reporting, momentary changes in share price. We saw it today in the fizzy drinks sector. The announcement of a sugar tax, suddenly your share price is falling off a cliff. So they may well be very motivated to do the right thing, but unfortunately they're not in control of their own destiny. And who is in control? Nobody individually is in control, but what we do know is that there is a clear ability for us as humans to work together and to act as citizens to address this risk, not as consumers. I hate the fact that we get reduced down to just how we spend money. We have a moral component to our lives and to the things that motivate us. And it's that citizenship that puts pressure onto politicians and companies to make them do the right thing. And far from being seeing governments as being locked into a particular way of supporting industry, governments respond to people, and they respond to voters, and they respond to citizens. And when we collectively make our concerns known, they act. And there's a good example of this, and that is the Climate Change Act. And of course, I would use that because that's the one I'm most closely associated with. But just on Monday, there was an amendment tabled to an energy bill that was going through the House of Commons by Ed Miliband, the former leader of the Low Party. And it commits the UK now to setting a target of zero emissions in law, an increase on our existing legal target. Now, the government's response to that was not a question of if, but when they will legislate for that target. Now, that is incredible. And it's incredible for lots of reasons, but one of them is that at the moment, if you read the headlines, you'd assume there is no unifying issue in British politics. It's a horribly divided landscape. People are worried about Brexit, in or out, referendum. We've got all sorts of views about different issues that are dividing us. But on this issue, we managed to restore a cross-party consensus and take action and keep the momentum of Paris alive, which the UK government played such a strong role in helping to achieve. So, I think the premise of the question is slightly wrongly phrased, and I'm certain that though many members of the private sector will play a role, the sector as a whole cannot be relied upon to lead. And another thing I would use in defence of this argument is that when we see, for example, I'll give two examples. When you look at how society delivers big infrastructure, big change, often it needs a big state involvement in that endeavour. The first example, and this is quite close to the St Paul's Institute heart, is the rebuilding of St Paul's Cathedral after the Great Fire of London. And that was funded by a tax on coal that was then used to rebuild St Paul's into the wonderful building that still survives today and is an amazing testimony to our aspirations and our ability to create something of lasting meaning for many, many people. Contrast that with the endeavour to mark the millennium. This is an important time in our history. And you see what private sector delivered, and that was the dome. I don't know anyone who thinks the dome is going to be an enduring symbol of human ingenuity and innovation. It was tarnished by the fact that it was seen to be expedient and quick and had almost no aesthetic appeal to it. And it rightly was pilloried at the time for being an enormous waste of time and money. And that just shows you that short-term thinking that is endemic in the private sector means that they find leadership hard and they find long-term planning very difficult. The other example I'd give is China. Now, I'm not saying China doesn't have many problems, and certainly their brand of capitalism and planned economy has many issues. But when it comes to having an ability to address climate change quickly, their style of command and control economy delivers far faster than the liberalized energy markets that we see in Europe. And the best example of that is their high-speed rail. Their high-speed rail system is world-class and was delivered in record speed. And I'd encourage anyone who thinks China can't do infrastructure to just simply travel on one of their high-speed rails that connects their amazing cities, and you'll see that they can do it very well. And they did it incredibly efficiently. Now, of course, they borrowed lots of the technology from private companies, and there was a private sector involvement in it. But essentially, it was led from the government deciding that the future of transporting their people was not going to be simply left to a market. They were going to plan for the future, and they planned in a sustainable way. So, as I said, I think there is absolutely a need for the private sector to play a role. It can't, unfortunately, lead. It's not a homogenous group for a start. And also, often what you'll find is that individual companies maintain two completely opposing positions, one long-term, and more likely the one that motivates them most is going to be the short-term. We don't need short-term thinking. We can't afford short-term thinking when it comes to climate change. It's the challenge of our generation, and it's going to involve every one of us as citizens guiding our politicians, who in turn then will guide the private sector in playing the roles that they can play. But we should never give up our own responsibility to play a part in this. It's collective leadership that will solve this problem. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So a useful reminder of the tragedy of the horizons, as the governor of the Bank of England coined it. If we're in a period of crisis, perhaps we should be on a war footing, and only the state can lead in that sort of situation. We're now going to give both speakers 5 minutes to respond to each other, but then we've got some time for questions from the audience, so do start to think what you would like to ask Bryony and Jonathan. But your 5 minutes.
Thank you. Thanks very much. I'll just do a sound check again. Is that all right? Bryony, some powerful arguments, but I'm going to continue to keep the spirit of the debate by saying that talking about leadership amongst many can be confusing, because generally in human endeavor there needs to be a leader, a point of focus. And I suppose the point that I was trying to make is that the private sector has the money, most of our governments do not, the courage and the innovative instincts to be given that lead. I think that many of your issues that you raised around the lack of homogeneity among the private sector, I would absolutely accept. And in my opening remarks, I said that it is government's role in our social contract to control the cheats, the liars, and the polluters, and I believe that very strongly. The point that I was making in my first argument is that government is too close, too tied, too locked in to provide that kind of oversight, and therefore loses its right to be in the lead. And my examples of that might be BP's Deep Horizon. It was a failure of a large company, a large British company, but it was one that was supposed to be regulated by the United States. It was a failure in both corporate behavior and government regulation. And there are many more instances, in my view, where government has abrogated its responsibility to regulating the private sector properly, consistently, and in the right issues that we care about as a society, because it is tied in to tax revenues and a range of other status quo issues, as I pointed out. I want to also say that I agree to some extent that governments respond to citizens and we are not defined by our consumption patterns. But I do believe that modern government has gotten too far away from the concepts of vision, leadership, inspiration, and that opinion polls seem to drive more government policy than a deep and a thoughtful understanding of how our society and economies are structured. And I know you know that because you led a very useful and powerful investigation into the UK's energy sector, specifically to unravel some of those issues. I think the UK's leadership is unquestioned, but its ability to deliver against that zero target, both in a very competitive world and resist the cries from the private sector to protect the losers. And I want to say that I couldn't agree more that there's a very varied response from business. And often the first response of the private sector is to resist regulation, but it shouldn't be the first response of government to cave into that. And it was Peter Bucker, who leads the World Business Council for Sustainable Development, the 200 proactive corporations as members, who said, actually at the last event at the All-Party Climate Change Group, who sort of said, what is this protecting the losers thing? There are winners and there are losers, and business knows that to be successful, you have to be profitable. You have to be relevant to society. If you can't win under those expectations, you don't deserve to exist in the economy. So I think on that one there, we need to be very careful. China, interesting example. Clearly one of the most polluted countries in the world. Citizens are dying from air pollution. It is the Chinese government's social contract that has forced them to become a leader in solar power, there's no doubt, to take action on transport, which is the major source of health-affecting ground-level air pollution. And it's the private sector, the emerging private sector in China, that has enabled it to move as fast as it has moved. In my previous life, I was involved in some of the privatization work in the ex-Eastern Europe countries, including Romania, Hungary, Poland, etc., and I have never in my life seen such terrible pollution as a result of centrally controlled economies. So, with time up, those were the points that I just wanted to pick up and respond to. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jonathan. So, how do we help the state deal with the people who are perceived to be losers and have that very loud voice?
How do I respond? Well, it seems to be a bit of a circular argument that governments can't lead because the private sector is so evil that they're so good at lobbying that then governments can't lead. So therefore, we should let the private sector lead, which, you know, I just feel actually this missing a bit of the equation, which is that we as citizens are actually collectively the people who appoint our democratic leaders, and that gives us collectively as much power, and we have voices that we can bring to the debate, and we do so. And I get lobbied, I've been lobbied, I've done lobbying, and it works. And it works because ultimately we're dealing with people who are they're humans. We all have a similar range of reactions to being asked to do something by somebody if it's a persuasive argument. But I don't think you can use the fact that over time governments have for certain supported certain sectors and certain activities probably wrongly, but equally they've supported very good things, and it's I find it a bit hard to accept that it's the fault of government when the lobbying that goes on is so intense and so well-funded and so disproportionate actually to the contribution that some of these sectors are making. I mean, you mentioned the governments are being in thrall to the tax revenues. Actually, the tax revenue from fossil fuels in the UK has been declining for a number of years and is falling fast now with the decline of the North Sea revenues. And actually, this is a bit of a secret, but the economists will tell you, oh yes, you should tax the things that you want to see less of in the world. That's not how treasuries think. Treasuries tax the things they want to see sticking around, because otherwise how do they pay for the running of the government? So actually it's absolutely true that if you're receiving revenues from the fossil fuel industry, that's because you hope that they're going to stick around. But something has shifted in the last, I'd say, 5 to 10 years, and that is suddenly the fossil fuels are no longer a reliable source of revenue. And so governments shift with that realization, and they are going to be, I think, embracing, and are already, you saw in the budget today, embracing clean technology as the new source of revenue that's going to keep them able to fund all of the works that governments do to maintain the fabric of society. So we're not locked in, far from it actually. We're able to respond and do respond to changes that are brought about by a combination of government leading, asking the private sector to respond and deliver a different set of priorities, and then innovation within the private sector showing that that can be done. And it's a dance between political conviction and confidence that there's a moral need to do something and setting out a path towards it, and then the private sector very often demonstrating that can be done far faster actually than government might have thought, and demonstrating that new technologies can be brought to market more cheaply than perhaps government felt was possible. And then one that with that in renewed confidence, governments move forward again, safe in the knowledge that actually that leadership that they delivered resulted in innovation and making the job easier. So it is a dance always. But who started the dance? I would argue civil society and governments started the dance, because they were the ones who realized the science was compelling and incredibly alarming. It wasn't the private sector who funded the scientists, who raised the flag, who pointed out the greenhouse effect. It wasn't the private sector who, back in the late 1990s, was stuffing envelopes at Friends of the Earth, trying to mobilize our membership to get active on this issue, to put pressure on our leaders. And it isn't the private sector now that's championing positive new regulations to drive innovation. There are some who talk about carbon pricing, and that is absolutely true, Jonathan's correct. But they talk about it in a very abstract way, in high-level meetings, flying around the world, telling everyone what we already know, carbon pricing is the answer. But when it comes to lobbying, the actual on-the-ground fixing of the carbon pricing policy, where are those private sector lobbyists? Hardly one to be found. It's the NGOs, it's the scientists, it's the civil servants who care, who are actually trying to change those laws to drive capital into the right direction. I'm not saying the private sector can't play a role, but honestly, my experience of them is they are not able or capable of putting aside the short-term profit motive sufficient for long enough, for enough time for them to lead on this. It's all of us, I'm afraid, that's going to have to do this. And thankfully, we've been doing it for at least 25 years. In the next 25 years, we'll have cracked it. And it will be collectively. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's now the time of civil society for you to have your time to dance. So we've got the questions. We've got a roving mic. And I'm going to take the questions three at a time. I'm going to start with this side. There's a lady in the blue cardigan for the first question.
I want to suggest that the main reason for climate change is that there are too many of us. And whoever is responsible, people must be encouraged to have fewer children so that we need to use up less of the land, denuding it, taking out the forests, spoiling the water table, all those really basic things before we get on to technology.
Thank you. And there's a gentleman there.
This has been a very interesting debate because there's been practically nothing said that I disagree with. But I do have a question for Jonathan, which is, if you assume that global warming is a global problem, why would you expect the private sector, which is inherently local, even with multinationals, why would you expect the private sector to be able to take the lead to deal with what's basically a global problem?
And then there was a gentleman with a jumper with red diamonds on it.
Yes, hello. My name's Paul Garrett, and I wondered, we're in a church, and I'm a Christian, and I believe that the church has a role to play, and I know we have an officer here from the Church of England, but it's very unclear to me what the church role is, because there's borders and things like that which have to be considered, and how much is that respected. I think the Bible respects borders and national borders, but what does that play into as far as Jesus and the healing of people is concerned? And that must take into account things such as pollution and water supply and adequate food and shelter.
Thank you. So a common theme running through the questions there, that this is a global problem. So what about the questions around global governance, multinational companies, and the church, which is one of the fundamental global organizations as well? So any of those that you'd like to answer?
Yes, thank you for those questions. I suspect we could keep debating this topic all night, so I'll try and be brief. But in response to the lady who's worried about population growth, I happen to believe that trying to solve climate change, we are forced to accept very non-human emotions, like, you know, you can't have children, then it's not going to work. You can't expect us as a society to take on that kind of privation. And I honestly think that there will be technological solutions that enables us to sustain our population, as we have done through the decades, at higher standards of living with less conflict, if we can get the right policies in place. And I know that sounds utopian, but there is already evidence that when you have rising prosperity, the birth rate naturally falls off. The reason we have growing population is because of poverty. So we've got to find the ways forward that enable us to protect our environment and increase our prosperity, and then the population growth that you refer to will level off, as it has done in all rich and developed countries. So I'm an optimist that we won't have to take those sorts of drastic steps. I hope that's at least it's my perspective. And as for the global problem, it's absolutely correct. But here perhaps I would agree with Jonathan that I don't think the task of global governments actually is sufficiently developed to really solve this. That's why it has to be collective, and that means we don't have a global parliament, we don't have a global governance. We have the best we've got is the UN, and that can deliver amazing results, but it's very hard to see how that alone is going to deliver a truly global response to this. So it's going to have to be a combination of individual nations taking turns to lead and inspiring others to follow. And I think that system of governance is the only one we really have, and it's the one that we're going to have to rely on. But again, we've shown that we can come together at certain times. Paris was an example of that. But the reality of Paris is that it puts the onus back onto individual nations, and we have to hope that a race to the top starts as opposed to a race to the bottom.
Thank you. And can we get a race to the top happening amongst multinational companies?
Yes. This shows that it's sometimes very difficult to have a debate, because I agree with so many things, Brony, that you've said. The population is the cause. I do believe that prosperity and development is really at the heart of that. So I've really little to add to Brony's view. I share that. The global problem and the governance, again, I think the reason why Paris was a success is that the UN realized that it was very hard to do a top-down solution for climate change and invited every nation to contribute their nationally determined contributions on a voluntary basis. So that speaks, I think, nationally. In terms of the corporate view, though, it is my experience with the work that we've done with companies like Microsoft or Marks and Spencer's, that they hold a very global view. And they hold an incredibly global view because their supply chains are deeply affected by current impacts from climate change. So, for example, we work with a UK tea company that is already feeling the impacts of climate change in its supply chain in Kenya and wants a solution, an adaptation solution rather than a mitigation solution in that part of the world. So I think it is global corporations that perhaps, and I'm getting back into debating mode here, have a worldview that is much more helpful than national governments have been able to project into our discussions on how to tame climate change. And certainly there's a view that cities or subnational entities that have more direct control, and I think that's to Brony's point, that communities taking control of their own cities or states seem to be more powerful than slightly removed national governments and more effective as well. And I would put corporations into the more effective bracket because of the supply chain connectivity that they experience.
Thank you. And we are going to have an answer on the church, specifically from Brian, after another round of questions, so we haven't forgotten that one. I'm going to take questions from this side. There's a gentleman there in a grey jumper.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for a really interesting debate. Baroness Worthington, you mentioned, with this great image, the short-termism of shareholder capitalism, and kind of the CEOs watching the share price tick away. I actually agree that the private sector can make a huge difference, but I think it's if that incentive changes from share price. How could you think of ways that might happen and orientate towards stakeholder capitalism instead?
And a question from the lady in the black jacket.
You all mentioned that you want to talk about carbon pricing, but we've already got a carbon market. We've got the carbon permits, and it's been a very lax system. So there must be some reform in the system, either from the governmental side or on side of business. So what do you propose? Because permits have been given away so laxly that there's been no incentive to change.
And there was a lady at the far side with her hand up there.
Collective action was mentioned a few times, Baroness, by yourself. And you could almost say that the private sector, if we're talking about collective action, is able to lead and influence their consumers more than government can influence their citizens. And for that reason, you could almost say that the private sector's remit or impact doesn't just end with its own operations or its own footprint, but actually extends to its millions of consumers across the world. And for that reason, could you not say that the private sector should therefore be leading?
Thank you. So three questions there, getting into the sort of heart of the system in many ways. So how do we make carbon pricing and the carbon markets work? How do we make shareholder capitalism work? And then those interactions between the state and consumers, how can we bring them into play? Do you want to go first this time, Jonathan?
Thanks. In terms of shareholder behavior, I think there's a lot going on in that space. I think the CDP, the Climate Disclosure Project, as it used to be called, backed by $95 trillion of investment money, is an example of where pressure is being brought to bear on companies to think longer term, to declare their climate risks, and to declare their strategies that they're putting in place to deal with those. I also think that there is a number of new movements that are reshaping the sort of Adam Smith role of the business of business is business, impact investing, and B corporations, and a number of organizations with a social goal rather than a profit goal. And these new methods or models for private sector activity are growing slowly but steadily, and I believe will increase in their influence. Just by the way, I chair a community energy co-op down in the south of England, and that would be a great example of a local community really taking control of an issue over which they feel very, very strongly. And the shareholder structure there, of course, is that it is owned by the community. The EU ETS, I'm always tempted, Bryony, to leave that to you, because Sandbag was right in that spot, and I think you're going to be really better qualified than I to speak to that one. And then the corporate's influence on consumers is a really interesting question. And in some respects, I'm not sure that that relationship is working as well as it could be, whether it's, you know, you're talking about a consumer or a voting member of the public. My sense is that corporates tend, unless they're highly innovative, to do what government does, which is listen to the polls, ask consumers what they want. And the real innovation that I think is driving a solution to climate change comes from businesses that anticipate what their consumers need and value without having to ask them, because we're pretty poor at expressing what it is that we really want. Nobody turned to GM and said, I want a Tesla fully electric car, or, you know, and battery storage and storage batteries that will store my solar electricity. Those things really need businesses to think on behalf of society, and I think that's a point that's come out quite strongly, and think of the issues that we're facing and solve them, and then be rewarded by consumer behavior.
Thank you. Bryony, we'll focus on carbon pricing ETS.
Yes, so I should declare an interest in that. I've been following the carbon market in Europe since its inception, and now in my new role at the Environmental Defence Fund Europe, I'm joining a global team of experts who work on carbon markets in every jurisdiction that they exist. So it is something close to my heart, and this is where I can probably, you know, stop debating Jonathan and admit that actually, you know, I'm a pro-market optimist, and I actually think the guiding hand of government is about creating well-run markets, and that's when you get the best of both worlds: the efficiency of the private sector at finding the solutions, and the government dictating the terms and the rules by which they operate. So we are very closely aligned, actually. And this is, the carbon market is a good example of that. Now, in Europe, you know, Europe's a tricky place, right? There's some things going on. We've got 28 member states, each with their own views on how their energy system should run. And we've managed to put them into one harmonized system that creates one carbon price. And that is quite remarkable. The only problem is, of course, that the price of inclusion, of getting them all in, was that we had to give away quite a lot of emissions allowances. Now, over time, those allowances will diminish. I mean, it's probably not widely known, but in Europe now, we have a law in place that takes all of our industrial emissions to zero by 2056. That's not that far away. And that's full, you know, there are no allowances left. So that is quite a remarkable tool. At the moment, it's delivering a weak signal, and there's still, even though we're 8 years in, quite a few rules that need to be tweaked. But like I said, you know, there's an active, very active lobby going on right now of NGOs and think tanks and all sorts of people joining in to fix that market, because it is so important. And I would like to see a few more private sector people helping, because it is a game of you know, men, people on the ground influencing the politicians to get the right results. I could bore you senseless about the detail of that, but I won't. And the non-consumers, this is fascinating. One of my very first jobs in government was to help design a communications campaign on climate change. And you know, we did our best. We did public films. We did all sorts of PR. We had competitions that we ran. We gave out grants, and we tried to bring climate change to people's front of mind. And I'm not saying we did everything perfectly, but at least we tried. I've yet to see a really good private sector advertising campaign that even really mentions climate change. I mean, you know, car manufacturers are not selling cars on talking about climate change. They're doing everything they can, actually, to subvert the regulations that we put in place to try and get them to address it. So I'm a bit cynical, I'm afraid. And I do think it would be great. It'd be great if I woke up in the morning and my Kellogg's box was not selling me a cereal bowl, but was asking me, you know, to do something about climate change. But it's not, that's not in the DNA of the marketing and advertising industry right now. Whether that will change as an enlightened self-interest takes root, I hope it might. And it's certainly, this is where partnerships with civil society groups and NGOs and private sector players can create quite interesting collaborations. And that's something else that Environmental Defence Fund has done very well over the years, partner with big retailers like Walmart, for example, to see whether we can combine our knowledge of the solutions and their reach to deliver really impressive change. So I'm not saying it can't be done, but I haven't yet got a really great example in the advertising or communication space that I can draw on. But it's early days, and I'm sure we can make that happen if the right partners come together.
Thank you very much. Well, we'll hear from both our speakers again at the end with some final conclusions. But I know a lot of you, and we had the question earlier, are here to hear the response of the church and hear what the church is doing. And we've had both speakers talking about the importance of civil society, and the church is one of the really important actors in that space. And we as investors have worked very closely with Christiana Figueres and her team, and I know she was incredibly appreciative of the work of the churches and people of faith globally. And Brian Cuthbertson from the Diocese of London is going to talk to us about that. Both he and I still think he's the only full-time environmental diocesan officer across the Church of England, looking after nearly 500 buildings in the London diocese and doing a fantastic job in the nitty-gritty of energy efficiency and also the bigger picture of advocacy. Brian.
Thank you very much, Helen, and thank you to you all. And I have been asked to respond to the talks we've heard so far as well. I've enjoyed listening to this debate, there's actually been a bit more points of disagreement than I was expecting, really, but I've also noted some convergence happening within the last few minutes. So I'm glad we're not going to be taking a vote on this. I don't think we are, because if we're discussing who's to give a lead, the public or the private sectors, the answer surely is both and others besides, including the voluntary sector, the whole of civil society, the church and all faiths, every mover and shaker, the infinite network of private citizens and the cultures that they comprise. All must be involved. This is not something as we've heard, this is not something like the Apollo project of sending a man to the moon, which can be directed entirely centrally by government. It's something that everybody needs to participate in. Clearly, we do have a problem with the public sector, and if that means the UK government, the motivations of the present government are far from clear to some of us. They've signed up to the Paris Agreement, but against that background, their actions in the last 2 years have been somewhat ambiguous, to put it kindly. And indeed, we've been told that government as a class are described as the least qualified to take a lead and as being deeply conflicted. So there is a problem there. But on the other hand, we can be heartened by an announcement like the one that we've heard today about the UK committing to set a date by which we will achieve zero emissions. That is deeply encouraging. And business and commerce, as we've heard, are also mixed in their responses, with some speaking and acting in a very helpful manner, others less so. So this is a balance and a combination of each sector in society needing to stimulate, spur each other, and to hold each other to account. But that is to say nothing so far of faiths and of the church and of the Church of England and the Diocese of London, which I represent. I've actually, by the way, just come this evening from a meeting in Westminster Cathedral, the Roman Catholic Cathedral of central London, where I was giving a talk to a small group about Laudato Si, the encyclical on the environment by Pope Francis. And that made a huge impression on society and contributed strongly to assisting in the delivery of agreement in the Paris talks last autumn. But clearly, as faiths and as a church, we have a long way to go. The Church of England and the Diocese of London are aiming to give a lead, and as far as this diocese is concerned, we have a brand name for it, Route 2050. This was initially launched in that guise in 2011, but we were already seeking to implement its aims. In particular, we have been measuring the energy use of our churches and church halls, of which there are nearly 500, as Helen said. And from this, we calculate their carbon emissions from every year to 2005 to 2014 so far. 2013 was our best year so far, showing 23% savings in energy and 16% savings in emissions. But we fell back a bit in 2014. There are, of course, peaks and troughs. But the peaks and the troughs and the trend line between them are all on a downward trajectory, albeit not as steep as the descent as we would like. So we do have to up our game considerably. The worldwide Christian Church ought, I believe, to be more united on this issue than it is. And I want to get a bit philosophical here, because I think it does depend a lot on people's underlying ways of thought. Pockets still remain of what is actually a neo-Cartesian or neo-Hellenistic dualism between spirit and matter, which thinks in some people's minds that we can scorn to be concerned with or constrained by the realities of our physical environment. This is a serious error. There are features of Neoplatonism to be found even in St. Paul, but he was not infected by this syndrome. On the contrary, he preached the redemption of all things. In other words, the physical order of creation of which we form part. And so should we be doing this. Nevertheless, we have to recognize the limitations upon leadership of any kind, Christian or secular, as a motivator of action by others. Leadership in itself can only take us so far. We need to ask, what are the main drivers of action by each individual person? It was claimed by Locke and Hume, the leading Enlightenment philosophers of the English-speaking world, that impressions generate ideas and that passions are the driver of actions. This was never more true than it is of climate change. People do or do not believe in climate change, depending even on their impressions of local weather. And they do or do not take action, depending on such things as the strength of their dependence on their motor car or their foreign holidays. Our ability to reform and remodel the wellsprings of human nature and culture really are at stake. Fundamentally, this is a cultural and a psychological issue, and even more fundamentally, it is a spiritual one. In Christian terms, we must become a new creation. The old humanity must give way to the new. That is a major challenge, and I leave you with this thought to ponder.
Thank you very much, Helen. Thank you for taking us to a different philosophical plane. And perhaps I can ask our speakers to motivate the people in the audience. You know, what can we respond to in terms of our passion, given that we all need to co-lead to get the emissions coming down in time? Bryony.
Oh, wow. So I would join a political party, doesn't matter which one, and ask your preferred candidate, what are you going to do to ensure that there are proper incentives, regulations and policies to make sure that we tackle this in a timely manner? And I think you can also, there's lots of personal actions you can take, but honestly, putting pressure on our political elected officials and elected representatives is one of the most important things we can all do. And it doesn't matter what political persuasion you're from, climate change reaches across the aisles and is something that we've all got to put at the top of the agenda.
Thank you very much. So there you are, there's a message to start to talk to your MPs and your other elected representatives. Any ideas from you, Jonathan?
Well, I think that as members of society, I would probably take a sort of a shift to the private sector and say, what can we collectively do to make the private sector better than it currently is? And then we spoke a little bit about shareholder activism. The ownership of much of the private sector could be yours, could be in your hands. So that same pressure, that same signal, that same engagement, positive engagement with the private sector, as Brony is advocating for the public sector, for government, I think really is powerful. We've slightly downgraded the importance of what we buy and how we use it, but that is quite important given the kind of consumer society that we live in. And letting businesses know and the private sector know about your concerns through the things that you do, the things that you say, what you might say as a shareholder in a company becomes very important as we try and move the bar.
Thank you very much. So hopefully everyone can take a few moments before they leave to think about what it is that drives your passion in this area and what you're going to do, and try and make sure that's through every action. I'm going to take this off. Try and make sure that's through every action that you do day to day. And to help you do that, we've actually got some drinks and refreshments for you, so you can share ideas, inflame your passion for what you're actually going to take away and take action on, because we really do need to start emissions falling quickly, and we need every single sector taking a leadership role. Make sure we've got the framework from governments, the right carbon price, those externalities being internalised, and that amazing passion that you see within the private sector, and certainly plenty of clues for me working in the investment industry, looking after church and charity money in terms of what I can do too. But I'd like to end by thanking both our excellent speakers, bringing their perspective from all the sectors that they've worked in and working with our binary question in terms of the debate. And also thank our organisers, JustShare and St Paul's, for bringing everyone together. And thank you all for coming, and enjoy the drinks and refreshments which are at the back. Thank you.